and shame keeps pulling you back. If you've looked for answers that the world don't have, come on down to the Tear Revival. Come and wait in the water blue. Come and feel that heavenly fire falling down on you.
Say goodbye to the water weary. Say hello to the brand new you. Hear that gospel song playing on. seen your power part the sea, or raise a dead man back to his feet. I'm just looking for glimpses, I'm looking for glimpses. But you stop my heart in the blink of an eye, in the miracle of my baby's smile. I'm just looking for glimpses, I'm looking for glimpses. I'm starting to see.
Disappointment, Sunday's empty too. Since when has impossible ever stopped you? This is the sound of dry bones rattling. This is a praise, make a dead man walk again. Open the grave, I'm coming out. I'm gonna live again. This is the sound of dry bones rattling. Pentecostal fire, stirring something new. You're not gonna run out of miracles.
Happy Easter to you. Man, it is a beautiful day. Not quite as good as last Easter weather-wise, but you know what? The grave is empty. And that's worthy of celebrating. That makes it a beautiful day, doesn't it? I want to welcome you here to Rocky Fork this morning. If you're joining us online, thank you for joining us. And we hope that you can come and visit us in person sometime soon. For those of you who are here, if it's your first time here, welcome. We're glad that you're here. And if you haven't on the way in, I want to encourage you to stop by the Welcome Center on your way out. We have a little gift for you if it's your first Sunday here with us. Also want to encourage you, in the back of the seat, there's these little connection cards. I want to encourage you to fill one of those out. We are going to have an amazing, amazing hour ahead, celebrating our risen Savior Jesus. We're gonna sing praises to Him. We're gonna hear from His Word. We're gonna take communion together, and all of it is gonna be about praising Jesus. And you know what? We're celebrating the risen Savior today. We're gonna do that again next week, because we do that every week here. But there's a couple of things that are specifically happening next week that I just want to draw your attention to. One is, starting at 10:30, we're going to have 4 food trucks in our parking lot. So I want to encourage you to bring your chairs and go eat after service, if you're a first service, or, well, after service if second service too. So next week, starting at 10:30, food trucks in the parking lot. And we're just going to have time to fellowship together. The other thing that's happening next week is we're starting a parenting class. And space is pretty limited in that class. But I want to encourage you, if you have any questions about that, check out the app. Go to the Welcome Center. They can help you out. But like I said, we're celebrating Jesus this morning. That's what we're doing. And it's going to be amazing time to praise Him. So would you stand and join us as we worship Him.
Joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in able to be here today. Praise God.
Satisfied here in your today. Praise God. If you haven't had a chance to grab your communion yet from the front of the back, I encourage you to do so, and you may have a seat. We want to teach you a new song today, and we'll take communion together during this song. We'll have a meditation in the middle. But the song's called Thank You, Jesus, for the Blood. And originally, the idea was we're just going to play part of it. It's too good. It's too good, especially on this day. So if you don't know this song, if this is the first time you heard it, I just encourage you, we'll have the words on the screen. Just pray through what we're singing. And just let the words speak to you. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood.
I was rich. I remember who I was. I was lost. I was blind. I was running out of time. Sin separated. The breach was far too wide. But from the far side of the chasm, you held me in your sight. So you made a way across the great divide, left behind heaven strong to build it here inside. And there at the cross,
that. What more important thing can we say than thank you? Thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you that you saved my life, that you moved us from darkness into the glorious light. That's what today's all about, is thanking Jesus, right? If you are new with us, we are glad that you're here. We're thankful that you've joined us. And it's important that sometimes we remind ourselves of what communion is. And so we're just going to take a moment to do that, all right? This may be something brand new to you. So, on the last night, before Christ would give up his life for ours, he gathered his closest friends around a table and had a meal together. And at that meal, he took some bread, and he lifted the bread up, and he gave thanks for it. And he broke it, and he handed it to his closest friends. And he said, take this. This represents my body. Do this in remembrance of me. And they ate the bread. And then after that, he took a cup of wine, and he lifted it up to God, and he gave thanks for it. And then he passed that cup of wine around. He said, take this. This represents my blood poured out for you. Do this in remembrance of me. That's what communion is about. I know Jonathan encouraged you to get your communion supplies, but if you didn't do that and you feel uncomfortable climbing over somebody, just raise your hand. The ushers in the back, they'll bring you your communion supplies too. We're going to take it together, okay? So in this moment, go ahead and peel back that wrapper. It's okay. It'll make a little noise. That's okay. It's all right. Peel back that wrapper. Get that wafer out. Okay. And we're just going to give thanks for the bread. And then we'll pray for the blood in just a moment. Let's pray. Father God, thank you for this bread. This bread that represents Christ's body broken to pay the price for our sins that we could never pay ourselves. Thank you that he gave up his body for us. We take this bread in remembrance of him. Take the bread. Now open up your cup. Let's give thanks for the juice that represents his blood. Father, thank you for the shed blood of Jesus, that it washed us white as snow, that our sins are cast away because he gave up his life and he spilled his blood for us. And we thank you for his blood that you've applied to our lives. We take this in remembrance of him. You know, Paul reflected on this moment gathered around the table, and he wrote a message that's good for us today. And it says this: every time we eat this bread and every time we drink this juice, we do this proclaiming Jesus' death until he returns. And proclaim is a strong word. It's not a somber word. I was reminded last night by a good friend that today is a celebration. This is a party, right? We can get all down in this somber moment, but it's really a celebration. So I'm going to ask you to do something that's maybe a little bit awkward, but I'm going to ask you to stand back up. Because the best position we can be in is one of praise, one of celebration. As we sing together, sing with all your voices, with all your hearts, with all your energy, and celebrate this gift we've been given in Jesus, the blood applied to our lives. Celebrate that together.
You took my place, laid inside my tomb of sin. You were buried for 3 days, but then you walked right out.
Don't you love those? Man, those are powerful. Only Jesus can do that, right? Only Jesus can do that. We are so thankful you're here. In fact, I'm thrilled. I'm excited to see so many faces and so many people here that this is such an amazing message. I'm going to start with kind of a traditional thing. We're not really a traditional church, but I want to start with this thing. I'm going to say something, and then there's a response that comes back, okay? I'm going to say God is good, and you're going to say?
All the time.
There you go. All the time. All the time. There you go. Yeah. Another thing that we would say in more traditional churches, we would say, He is risen. He's risen indeed. That's right. That's right. Jesus is alive. That's why we're celebrating this morning. That the tomb has been rolled away. He's come out of that grave, and that He is risen, and He is risen indeed. Everything that we talk about this morning is going to hinge on those two truths that we just talked about. God is good. Yeah. And Christ has risen. Yeah. So everything we talk about is going to be on that resurrection and the goodness of God. You see, the message of Jesus' life, death, and burial and resurrection, they have amazing power. And you just saw that on the videos. That's the thing that Jesus came to do, to seek and save the lost, those who are broken, to bring us into a loving relationship. He's the one who unlocks. He's the one that unlocks the prison doors and lets us out. So this morning, the whole theme of this message is how are we going to respond to an amazing message? How are we going to respond that Jesus walked out of the grave? What's that going to look like in my heart? What's that going to look like in your heart? These videos are really testimonies of what Jesus did and how people responded to that message. The who they were and who they are now. It's really simple. The response, believing in Christ, and it comes with endless benefits. The forgiveness of past sins. The shame and the guilt that we so often struggle with. That we need a fresh start. We need grace. We need to belong. We need acceptance. We need to be set free from our old lives. This is that opportunity. This is that opportunity to respond, to become who God is calling you to be, who He has set in motion to bring you into. So if you're ready to listen, I'm ready to preach. Okay. All right? All right, here we go. Here we go. The ministry of Jesus, the why He came into the world is really simple. Let me just kind of melt it down and put in some really basic concept, all right? He came to rescue us, every one of us. Nobody is outside of the boundaries. Nobody is outside the fence. Nobody has done something so bad that you can't be saved. So if you're thinking this morning, I'm here, and I know this is kind of religious. This is what people do who believe in God. I don't know where I'm going to fit in. This is where you fit in. This is about you. Jesus came for you. That God created the world, and in the beginning, everything was perfect. His creation was amazing. Adam and Eve were perfect. But then we know they get unperfect, right? That something happens, that sin is introduced in the world by Satan himself, right? He tempts them, and they do this thing. How many bass fishermen do we have out there, right? Yeah, you use a shiny lure, right? So this shiny lure goes by, and Adam and Eve bite, right? And there's a hook. The hook is sin. The temptation is the lure. And the downside, it has a price. There's a curse. and it falls upon all of mankind, that we all will sin. They sin, therefore sin came into the world. And if you're going to turn on the news, maybe you've already watched some news this morning or this afternoon, it's not all about Easter. The world is not celebrating with us the resurrection of Jesus. They are looking at the fallen, broken. They are fixated on the problems of the world. And we are here this morning celebrating a risen Savior. Do you see the difference? We have hope, and they are hopeless. Now, this is where you and I get caught up in the story. Sin enters the world, and it affects all of us. Romans chapter 3, verse 23 says this, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." Well, Paul is painting this picture of a target, right? The glory of God is the target, right? And if you were an archer and you pull back your bow and you shoot, either you're going to go over the top of it and totally miss it, or you're going to fall way short. That's what he's talking about. That picture of missing the perfection, that are missing it because of sin. So that's the curse of sin, which separates us from God. And then there's a punishment that goes along with that. The punishment is Romans chapter 6, verse 23, where it says the wages or the cost of sin is death. Now, I tell you these things because I'm going to lead back. I want to make this big circle back to why Jesus came. We can't fix ourselves. How many of us have tried, right? Yeah. And I am chasing my tail. I feel like a hamster on the wheel, right? Trying to fix me. I tell you these things because I want to circle back to why Jesus came, that God sends his son to cure both problems, sin and death. John 3:16, familiar verse. "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life." And these are familiar verses, and they help us to set the framework for why we need to know Jesus and love like him, that why we need to celebrate this moment, because this is powerful. That God loves you way too much to leave you in the broken place he found you. So I don't know how you came in here this morning, in what condition your heart is, or all the things that you're dealing with, the tomorrow, the today, all the things that are set ahead of you, all the things that you have to do. I don't know how you came in here, but I can tell you in this moment, God loves you, and there's a response to that hope. The outcome can be so much better than what you're worried about tomorrow. Without Jesus, we are hopelessly condemned. We will suffer in this life. Then we will face death for an eternity, separated from God, in hell, because of our sins. Now, I know that sounds harsh on an Easter message, but that's why Jesus came. And that feels tragic, because it is. It should send chills down our back. It should stir within us a desire, a compassion, because people are separated from God and hopeless without Jesus. That's why he came. That's why we celebrate this morning. He came to break us out of the chains of sin, to break us out of the prison we had put ourselves in. The story of Jesus' birth, right? His life, all the way up to the resurrection, can be described as miraculous. One story after another, one healing after one conversion, one moment after another, starting from the very beginning, from the virgin birth, it is a miracle. His teachings, his love, his miraculous powers are nothing short of God revealing his power through his son Jesus. The miracles credential who Jesus is. The stories, the miracles, they show what Jesus is capable of doing. And it's not just locked up in a margin of time for 3.5 years. Don't think of it as that's the last time the miracles happen. Each and every one of you are miracles. The fact that some of you even rolled out of bed this morning is a miracle. Right? That you got a teenager here or a middle schooler and they had their shoes on. What a miracle. All joking aside, it's the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus that makes us pause and consider our own life, our own death, and our own resurrection. The miracles are amazing. But the resurrection, that's like a new level, right? That there's hope. I mean, think about it. How else, if there's not so much hope attached to it, how else can a man who lived 2,000 plus years ago, how is it that he is so popular, so powerful that we're celebrating his resurrection today, unless it's true? We're not celebrating because it's a cool story, right? We're not celebrating because it's tradition. We're not celebrating because Jesus was famous. We're not celebrating because his first followers, those early disciples, were really good storytellers and fooled the world. We're not doing that. We are celebrating because we too have life because of his resurrection. The resurrection story is amazing because Jesus walks out of the grave. He defeats death and sets us free from our sins. I'm going to read some scriptures, and there's quite a bit of them. So I want you to kind of, if you have your Bible, I want you to open them up. If you don't, you can follow along the app. They'll be up on the screens also. Matthew chapter 28, verses 1 through 9. Matthew writes, "After the Sabbath," which is a Saturday, yesterday, "at dawn on the first day of the week," Sunday, which is today, says Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to the tomb. "There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and they became like dead men." When I picture this, I kind of giggle because I think of fainting goats. Right? Right? Or maybe you're more like MMA or boxing. When somebody gets knocked out, they got the stiff, right? They fall over. Yeah. Kind of that kind of sphere and paralyzed and fall over. Like dead men. "The angel said to the women, 'Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where they lay him. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you.' So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to the disciples. How many people have run when you're scared? It's not a pretty sight, is it? Right? It's like you're kind of, and you grab the person in front of you and kind of pull them back too, right? Like, I don't have to beat everybody, I just have to beat you, right? John tells the other part of this story in John chapter 20, verses 2 through 10. He kind of picks up after the running women get to the place where they're going. He says, so they came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, they have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they put him. So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. Let me just pause here for a minute. I didn't know there was a race, right? It's funny because the other disciple is actually John, who's writing this. And what John is doing is saying, I'm faster than Peter. I beat him to the tomb, right? Said he reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb, saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in place, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. Why does he keep pushing Peter? Like, I beat you, right? He went inside, he saw and believed. What did he believe? It's a good question, right? He believed that Jesus is alive. Now, here's what's fascinating about that, and also kind of ties this all together, is nearly a year before this epic event takes place, this Easter Sunday morning, Jesus foretells or describes to his disciples exactly what's going to happen a year before it ever happens. Jesus tells them, I am going to Jerusalem, and in Jerusalem, I'm going to suffer a horrible death at the hands of evil men, the religious leaders. He also told them that it is God's will that he would die for the sins of the world, but don't worry, that God would raise him up after 3 days. Coincidence? Good luck? Happy accident? Chance? I don't think so. Jesus is telling them, before it ever happens, this is the way it's going to go down. This is exactly what's going to happen. So when they walk into that tomb and they look and they see he's not there, you imagine the flood of memories that come back as Jesus spoke those words? Oh, yeah. It's just like he said it was going to happen. Paul would even say this. He would say this to every Christian, every place that he would go. He starts all these different churches all around the area. Paul would take it to this point. He would say, remember this of first importance, that God's people, we should remember what happened the day Jesus defeats death. Here's what he would say, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 3 through 6. He would say this, for what I received I passed on to you as first importance. In other words, remember this, is really, really important. That Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. That he was buried and he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures. And he appeared to Cephas, who is Paul, or is Peter, and then to the 12. And after that, he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers and sisters at the same time. Paul is writing and saying, listen, remember this. This is the evidence that I want you to hang on, to cling on to be able to weigh out and say, did this happen or did it not? It happened exactly as Jesus said it was going to. And here's all the evidence of how it went down. All right, we might be asking the question, right? So this has been good. This has been good, right? But what's this mean? What's this matter to me, right? How does it have any bearing? How is this going to make my day or my tomorrow any better, right? Because I came in here with a lot of junk, and you don't have time for me to tell you everything that's going wrong in my life. How can this help? Let me start by saying this. Jesus died for your sins, not the person sitting next to you. They get the benefit, right? But Jesus died for your sins, for my sins, for everyone in this room, for the entire world. We don't get to pick and choose whose sin is covered and who's not. We don't get to set the laws or the bylaws or the qualifications for the blood of Jesus to cover sin. Jesus died for the sins of the world, every one of them. So whatever you're thinking in your mind, I'm not sure if that's covered. Just throw that out, because it is covered. He died for the sins of the world, and God raised him from the dead to secure for you a place in heaven. That both sin and death have been defeated by Jesus. The blood covers the sins. The resurrection covers the death. And when we look at scriptures, every time this story is shared, people respond. People respond. They hear it, they understand it, they realize this is for me, and then there's a response that takes place. The disciples, the closest who were with Jesus for 3.5 years, they had a response. Maybe not verbally, but their response was lived out. Every one of them, except for Judas, lived their entire lives until it was taken from them or it was given up. All of them lived their lives for Jesus Christ. That's their response. That I would die for Jesus. Mary Magdalene, she called Jesus Rabbi when she realized that's who he was. Face to face with Jesus, and she recognizes his voice and who he is, and she says, Teacher, Rabbi. The very first Sunday evening, that Jesus appears to his disciples in an upper room, right? There's this moment where Jesus, the doors are locked because they're fearful of any of the Roman soldiers or the religious leaders are going to round them up too. So they're in this locked room, and all of a sudden, Jesus appears. And they have this opportunity to talk with him, to eat with him, and to touch and witness a risen Savior. They believed. And then there's Thomas, right? Oh, Thomas. Right? We call him the doubter, right? Because Thomas wasn't there that first night. He wasn't amongst all of his peers. And so when they told him that, hey, you missed out. Jesus came. We got to touch him. We have the benefit of knowing, you know, and Thomas is like, well, you know, I'm from Missouri, so you're going to have to show me, right? I know it's a bad joke. So Thomas gets this moment, right, where Jesus comes to him the very next Sunday. And he gets to examine Jesus' hands and his feet and his side, one-on-one, face-to-face. And Thomas's response is powerful, and it gets me every time. Thomas said, "My Lord, my God." And then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed." Now that's amazing, it's just in itself. But listen to what he says next. "Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." That's you and me. That's you and me. That we would have that kind of hope, that kind of faith, that we would trust in what's being told to us, what's being witnessed, that we would carry that message so powerful that we would believe it even without touching Jesus. Jesus says we're blessed. The Jewish people in Jerusalem, they responded to the good news of Jesus when it was being preached. Peter had this, he made it incredibly clear that Jesus was God's son. He made it incredibly clear that God had sent him what nobody else could do. Remember when Jesus dies, he dies for our sins. He paid the debt and he sets us free. He defeats death and is raised from the grave. And the chains of sin are broken. In Acts chapter 2, verse 36 through 38, Peter is preaching maybe to the people who were even there, maybe some of them in the crowd are even the ones who said, "Crucify him." And they're listening. And Peter says, "Therefore, let all of Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah. King and Christ. Jesus." It says, when the people heard this, here comes their response. When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart. Why were they cut to the heart? Because they didn't believe in the first place. Because now they realize God has done something amazing in this Jesus whom we just sent to the cross. Or maybe they realized those were my sins he died for. And maybe like us, we should also reflect, what would be my response? That Jesus died upon a cross for my sins, and suddenly now I'm feeling this moment, this cut to the heart moment. And Peter says, and the other apostles, and Peter says, "Brothers," they say, "Brothers, what shall we do?" And Peter says, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you'll receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." Those videos, those are real. Those are people who made this decision. They responded to an amazing message: freedom from sin and defeating death. And now that you have heard the good news and know the truth about Jesus, about his resurrection, about the goodness of God, how will you respond? What's going to be your answer? What's going to be your response? It could be the most impactful, the life-changing, death-defying, calendar-clearing, most courageous act of declaring your freedom in Jesus Christ that you will ever make. And it begins with believing that Jesus is the Son of God. Confessing that you're going to trust him with all of your life. Turning from our sins, knowing that we can't fix ourselves. Man, I've tried. But God is good, right? All the time. All the time. And then we would run to him for help, surrendering ourselves in baptism and being made new and joined to Jesus, who makes all things possible. Here's how you can respond this morning. At the Welcome Center, there are going to be people out there, and they have T-shirts on, and blue and gray shirts. Chad, stand up for me. Just show everybody your shirt. That's what those shirts look like, all right? They don't all look like Chad, so he's not that scary, all right? Those are decision counselors. Those folks can help you walk through this decision. They can help you build your story and change it. So you can have this moment where you realize, I no longer have to walk in the past, in the shame, in the guilt, in the sins. I no longer am imprisoned. And if you're ready, they're ready to walk beside you to help you take that step. Jesus is alive. Now's your opportunity to call on His name and follow Him. Let's stand and worship.
Why would I worry? Giants come calling my name. My God is so much bigger than the troubles I face. Why would I hunger for power or riches or fame? My God is so much better than all of these things. I won't be shaken. I won't be moved. My God is
much for joining us today. If you have any questions, find somebody with a shirt on. Visit our Welcome Center. They'll answer anything you've got. You can come talk to any of us staff as well. Have a great week. We'll see you next Sunday for Food Truck Sunday, 9 and 10:30 a.m. Have an awesome week.
God, I'm on my knees again. God, I'm